Please start.
Hello, everybody.
Hi, everyone. I, Dr. Shruti Mahajan, and Dr. Tushar Om Prakash are the moderators for today's webinar. We welcome you all to TopGun's IRSI International Webinar 2020, which is sponsored by Johnson & Johnson. We hope you are all keeping safe and healthy amidst the COVID-19 outbreak.
Dr. Shruti and I are cataract and refractive surgeons at Dr. Om Prakash Eye Institute, India. The objective of this webinar is to simplify routine and complex situations in cataract and refractive surgery. To meet this, best surgeons from around the world would put forth their tips and tricks for all of you to take home and implement them in your upcoming surgeries.
Let's have at what today's session TopGun's is all about. I'm going to share my screen here. Can everyone see my screen? Is my screen visible to everyone?
Yes, it is.
We have to open that first, Shruti. Yeah. Open it and then share screen.
Yeah, it's open, ma'am.
No, it's not.
It's not open.
Shruti, you need to open the player and then share the player.
Open it, pause it, and then share it.
All right.
Pause it, open, pause, and then share, and then replay.
Is it visible now?
Perfect.
Pilots, the tough panelists, and the excited audience. Each presentation today would last for about 4 minutes. After each presentation, a discussion round will be held for 3 minutes by the panelists. We will now run through a very quick tutorial for using the webinar platform for the speakers as well as the attendees.
This webinar is open for discussion for both the panelists and the audience. If anybody has a question, you can type it down in the chat box, which will be addressed to during the question and answers round, followed by each presentation. An audience poll and panelist poll will be recorded after the speakers of one team have finished presenting. The same shall be done once the second team is through. The best team will be awarded based on the poll results towards the end of the webinar. You will get 30 seconds to cast your vote for each category.
So are we all ready? Let's begin the action. Taking off first is Captain Viper, aka Dr. Vasavara's team. Over to Captain Viper.
Well, the Vipers are ready and they are brilliant, gifted and seasoned surgeons, extraordinarily teaching skill, and some of them are genius, nothing short of that. So we begin now with our most prestigious experience, Dr. Rohit Homkast.
We can't hear you, Dr. Rohit.
You've got to tell him to unmute. Everyone's muted, so you got to unmute.
Yes,
Dr. Can you hear me now?
We can hear you now.
Yes.
We can hear you, Rohit.
So I will be discussing phaco pearls as easy as it can be. My first pearl is going to be about chopper shield in black cataracts. You can see this is a brunescent cataract, and I would like you to focus on the chopper. You will find that the chopper is placed anterior to the phaco tip, between the phaco tip and the corneal endothelium. So now I would like you to focus where all the phaco chopper is going to move. This phaco chopper is going to help me avoid the touch of the hard nuclear fragments to the corneal endothelium by all means. Phacoemulsification is being carried out at a deeper plane, replenishing of the anterior chamber with a viscodispersive will all be done. See how I am smartly placing. So what I suggest is use the chopper diligently and you will have pristine clear corneas right on day one. See how I'm placing the chopper between the phaco tip and the corneal endothelium. See the pristine clear corneas on day one. So that was the first pearl. The second pearl is equatorial immobilization in Morgagnon cataracts. See the dancing nucleus. You will find that it is dancing all around, and because of the fact that the bag is empty and the cortex is liquefied. Now, how do we immobilize it? Take the equatorial support. Mark my words, if you take the equatorial support, you will not have any problem when it comes to managing these Morgagnon cataracts. That was pearl number two for Morgagnon cataracts. Next is, how can you use internal things like nucleus scaffold for zonulopathy? You will find that there is an area of zonular dehiscence, which means I have to have some support of any sort, anytime. But when you see the nuclear fragments are placed in the area of zonular weakness, there's a support. So I use CTR for that matter, and I use hard nuclear fragments. Mark my word, it is the hard nuclear fragments which act as an internal scaffold. After the CTR is well in place, the nuclear fragments are repositioned. So reposition nuclear fragments, which should add as an added adjunct to the already, you see how I'm repositioning and taking care of that. So next is the reverse angled initiation in intumescent cataracts. Just see how I initiate. It's the reverse. So now what is the advantage of this reverse? The reverse is that it comes, the flap comes directly under your vision. See the reverse initiation. It's an intumescent type, but it was very much under my vision, under my control. Now I find that it is going, see how I am placing it, closing the flap, and once the flap is closed, the circular small rexus is completed. After debulking, you can always complete the rexes of the size which you want it to be. Last but not the but the most important is whenever you have an urgent Indian flag sign, don't hesitate in continuing so long as the flap, as you will find the stripe and blue stained flap is averted and fluttering. So fluttering flap is conclusive that it is pre-equatorial and you can put even an IUL in the bag. And once it gets post-equatorial, then it's a wrap around tier. And if it's a wrap around tier, as it is not fluttering, this means you should convert. So that was the time when it should have been converted. Because if you continue with a flap which is inverted, you will end up with a situation wherein you will have a nucleus drop. So trifles make perfection, and perfection is no trifles. Thank you very much.
Excellent, Dr.
Simply brilliant, Rohit.
These were simple pearls that we all can go back and implement in our ORs. Dr. Packard, I would like to know, do you come across many more Gagnians in that part of the world?
Can you stop the slide share, please?
Dr. Packard.
No.
Dr. Rohit, can you stop?
Yeah. I see them very unusual. We get them occasionally, and we get plenty of white cataracts and brown ones, but a Morganian, maybe one a year, I see.
So what's your take on the equatorial support for the Morganian cataract?
I think it's very useful. I mean, the biggest problem with these is you've got a relatively small nucleus in a big bag, and the nucleus itself tends to be like a piece of India rubber.
Right.
So you try and bury it, and chopping them is incredibly difficult unless you have a technique for doing this.
Right, thank you. Dr. Wana, in your opinion, what can prevent an Argentinian flag sign? Dr. Wana.
Vanas.
Oh, sorry. I didn't recognize my own name. Being aware, first of all, of the possibility that this could be one of the Argentinian flag sign cases, and making a very small opening and sucking out the pressure, the cortex, which usually comes out, is a good way.
Right. Can we have Dr. Vajpayee? Dr. Rasik Vajpayee? Do we have him?
I don't think he has joined.
I don't think he has joined. No, he's not joined.
Right. Dr. Mahipal, what in your opinion what can prevent the Argentinian flag sign?
Obviously, in the Argentinian flag sign, there are two important things. One is the pressure that is there, the intradenticular pressure, what exactly, and also the upthrust that is there from the vitreous. So you have to look at both these things. The ways you can do is, A, to reduce the intumescence of the nucleus. So there are certain things where you just can go in and aspirate it out. So you have to actually decompress the intradenticular pressure. And the other thing that we often do is when it is phacomorphic glaucoma and things like that, where there is some fluid misdirection, we go in through the pars plana and just let some vitreous or whatever the fluid is that come out. So these are the two pearls that you have. Either you decompress the nucleus, remove the intumescence, do a small capsulorhexis, use a viscoelastic, which is high molecular weight, etc. Some people have said punctorhexis, which Mohan says, but I have never tried. But the idea is to make as small an entry into the capsule and reduce the pressure within the lens, or also decompress the vitreous. So these are the two things. There are several methodologies to do that. So that is how we manage the intumescent cataract. And obviously, femto is something where it is a closed chamber, and you often tend to get great capsular excess in intumescent cataracts. And for us, it's a treatment for phacomorphic glaucoma, and for large intumescent cataracts, femto capsulotomy is a choice treatment for us.
Excellent. Thank you, panelists. Taking off next is Dr. Gaurav Luthra. He's presenting my two cents.
Thanks, Shruti, and
Tushya, and thanks to all the organizers for inviting me. And the Vipers are going to get them, the Mavericks, as always. So I'll be sharing my screen and sharing my 2 cents. Okay, so I think, do we have slideshow? Yeah. So I'll be sharing a couple of pearls, and I'll be starting off with my first pearl. And let's hope the Vipers can strike. So, you know, when tackling these, I know that Dr. Vasavada is showing some good posterior polar stuff. I wanted to put in one or two pearls there, which are different from what he might be showing. So typically when we are dealing with posterior polar cataracts, I'll just mute this for a moment. So this is of course a rexus marker. So nothing unusual about this cataract surgery till the point that we get to removing the, you know, I'm just debulking the cortex from the bag of the equator of the bag. And I've so far managed to do a good job. I've removed much of the cataract, no hydro dissection. And I've, you know, painfully gone and, you know, kind of removed the bulk of the cortex from the periphery. And at this point, I thought that, you know, I'm home and I'm now just disengaging the last part from the periphery, from the equator of the bag. And at this point, I feel that I'm now free of the posterior capsule, but, you know, I'm not home yet. And what happens is that as I think that I'm home, this thing suddenly gives way, and as some of you may have experienced, the posterior capsule can rupture right in the end because that posterior capsular plaque is stuck right there at the posterior capsule. So what I go and do is here, of course, I managed to put in a three-piece lens. I managed to, you know, avoid any kind of vitreous prolapse, but I'm able to get this out. Now, how do we avoid this? Let me take you to the next situation where I will show how I can, you know, typically avoid this. So coming on again, hydro delineation, no hydro dissection, dissecting an endonucleus. And typically I go again to the same stage where I have debulked everything, left the posterior capsular adhesion intact, thinking that there is an adhesion. And this patient had a other eye, fellow eye had a PC rent and then, you know, fixated IOL. So see what I've done is, let me take you back again. What I've done is that when I've debulked everything, I'm not going to pluck it from there. I'm just going to go from the side and do a visco dissection. Now visco dissection or even a hydro, you know, like a, with a bimanual, if you can just push pass a fluid wave gently from the side, it kind of lifts this up. I prefer viscoelastic. Some people like to do it with BSS, but with visco, you will definitely be able to avoid any kind of a PC break over there. And this is how I usually manage this. And a small third pearl, and this is an unusual case. I like to do a femto-assisted surgery for my posterior polars with the offset. Their offset is at about 1,000 microns or 800 microns. Again, managing to get most of those chopped pieces out. Once I've done a 6-quadrant, it's easy to get these out. But as you can see, because there is no hydro dissection, there is some pneumo dissection, of course. We've reached a stage where we've managed to dissect out much of the nucleus, and we are left with this small shell, the epinuclear shell. Now just watch carefully what happens as I go in and just watch. You saw that thing? There's a pupil snap sign. And I've not done anything. I've not even started aspirating. Just watch this again. I've not even started aspirating. I'm just beginning to start and there it goes. Now the reason why this went off was because the infusion pressure, my staff had forgotten and we had kept the infusion at 62. Watch, now I'm down to 40. I was pressurized at 65 or something. And I had usually my settings would change. So I would go at a low IOP, but here the suddenly that thing gave way. So now how to tackle this? Now in this situation, we'll manage it. I'll go with a vitrectomy and I'll be able to clear off everything, you know, patiently. If you don't allow your pressure chamber to depressurize, you use viscoelastic, all those pearls that we all know. I managed, but, and now I go with viscoelastic, put in a lens. The second learning from this cataract case is that when I put in my lens, I've done a vitrectomy and I put in my three-piece lens. I've enlarged my incision nicely to 3.5. I don't want to take chances with injecting the three-piece lens and it becoming clumsy. I've put in the lens, deepened the chamber. Now I want to do an optic capture. Now just watch. My typical settings for femto is 5.2 rexus size. I've captured the lens. It doesn't stay. So the problem is that now when I'm capturing the lens, it goes in and you have the edge coming up, but it doesn't stay. I managed to finish the case, but lesson number two, go for a 5 millimeter rexus if you want to do an optic capture, and this will usually take you home. And these are the three pearls with my posterior polar cataracts that I wanted to share with you today. And I'll stop here. I hope these were useful for the people who are viewing this.
Wonderful, Gaurav. Excellent tips. Very useful.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
It's a priceless sense by Dr. Gaurav.
I'd like to ask a question. Hello.
Yeah. Dr. Vana, what is your opinion on it?
I would like to ask a question. Why would you think that the femto is a good solution in a posterior polar?
Sure. So conventional wisdom would say that femto would be contraindicated in posterior polar because, you know, you're creating more pressure with the air and with the dissection. So typically what we do is that I've been doing posterior polars for quite some time now with the femto platform. We do the offset is set less, the energies are low. We do a 6-quadrant CAC. So we don't really have too many, air bubbles being created. And the advantage is that you've managed to crack it into 6 pieces and your manipulations of the nucleus are going to be minimized. In fact, I tend to remove the 2 or 3, pizza pies and no rotation. So it becomes much easier. I just go in and separate out the 3-6, fragments with almost no vacuum, no manipulations. And then I can just remove them one at a time without having to do any rotation. So I feel in my hands, femto works really well.
Karina, the fear I think many of us had when we had this flex that there could be pneumo rupture of the posterior capsule because Michael Lawless group showed it initially. Now we understood the energy levels, the bubbles are very small, and they actually do not rupture. Since then, there has never been a rupture. So that pneumatic rupture is kind of more of a stressful imagination. I would say it almost never happens. So I don't think we need to worry about it. I think I will show you if you stay tuned. This is something which is really a great help in this kind of cataract.
Gaurav, when you went back into the eye in the case where it ruptured, when you put the irrigation back on, what you have to remember is that the posterior capsule is very thin in these eyes. It's much thinner than a normal eye. And what you have to do is actually do a fluid visco exchange before you come back out of the eye. And what you saw there was a posterior pupillary block, essentially, which is what pressurized the eye, and he just blew out the capsule. I mean, I wasn't in the least bit surprised that happened when I saw your case.
I understand. I agree. And typically what I would do is I would leave my main wound, kind of open at that point. And with my aspiration port, I would just allow the fluid and the visco to flow out. And I would go with lower settings. I would typically go at about 35 to 40 IOP because, you need to equalize the pressures between the anterior and the posterior to the capsule. If either way the pressure exceeds the other side, there's going to be a PC break. It doesn't have to break behind. It can even break if the vitreous pressure is high or the anterior chamber. And you have very valid points there, Dr. Richard.
The other thing is, because you're using a centurion in these cases, you can actually slow down the IOP ramp to 3 seconds, which right. means that the rise of the irrigation fluid going into the eye happens slowly. So it's, again, it's much less likely to happen.
Thanks.
Gordon, I have one quick question from Dr. Hart here.
Yes, Dr.
Chopper. In the vein of Top Gun, I consider the anterior capsule to be like my parachute, not only in posterior polar cataracts, but in regular cataracts. So anytime we might break the posterior capsule, we don't want to ditch our parachute, right? So we want to make sure that rex is of an adequate size to be able to do optic capture. And if we do that, we're going to save ourselves not only in posterior polar cataracts, but anytime we might encounter a posterior capsular rupture. One of the other things is when you're flying, you have to worry about pressure, right? And these eyes, especially the posterior capsule being so thin, breaks very easily with any changes in pressure. So we want to make sure that there's no hypotony at any point in time. And I think that'll save your posterior capsule a whole lot more often in these posterior polar cases.
Thanks, John. We love your dress as from the OPL. I have a quick question. There are so many stalwarts, so I can't, but, wish to ask a question.
I just want to make a point, Gaurav.
Yes.
You did visco dissection. I would rather do it in 3-4 hemimeridians or 3-4 meridians all around, because in your case, it was not stuck, so it was okay. But if it is right. stuck, rather than doing it with one bolus and, making that thing happen immediately, if you just do a little bit of visco dissection from all sides in 5 or 6 meridians, then even if the center part is stuck, you are still saved.
Thanks, so, Namrata. I think that's a great tip. I have a quick question from everybody there. Yes, Arun.
Yes. One second, you need to tell this to the audience because I think even I have the same difference which I was going to say. Whenever you are dealing with a posterior polar cataract, do not go in the center and put visco because you will immediately get the rent. Your case didn't have a rent, so it didn't happen. So actually, it should be from the periphery, leaving the center right till the very, very end to take out this thing. So I would say that is a tip. The other two tips were great, but here I have a slight different view on that.
Thanks, Dr. Maipal. For me, it's been working, so I do it for one or two areas, but it works well for me every time. I have a quick question. What is your ideal size of the Rexis for doing an optic capture? I've never had this problem before. And with a 5.2 here, I got stuck. You know, the thing would not capture because the Rexis was too big for the optic to get captured. It would keep coming off every time.
If your lens is too large, then also this may happen that, I don't know, Dr. Vasavada can also comment on it, but if your rent is too large, then this may happen that, you know, it's kind of unstable.
And I think anything more than 4.8 millimeter with compromised capsule, it can be dicey. So 4.8 is my figure.
How about making an oval Rexis for that matter?
I think you can. And Kiranjit from Amritsar, your town, does it, and he does it very well.
And I have been also doing it, and it's a great adjunct. I think
I endorse that.
Yeah. I've been telling JJ to give us an oval Rexis on the catalyst, but we still don't have one till we, you know, get that. Maybe thanks.
I'd like to add a comment. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So first of all, like I've mentioned before, the salvage was excellent, but you don't prepare for failure. So there is no need for oval capsule. First of all, you're preparing for failure. Two, femto laser, the only use is a mature intumescent cataract is subluxated. That's fine too. It's not an indication for PSC. You can do it. I don't recommend it. PSC, the most important part of polar cataract was the visco dissection. Coming from the periphery from three sides, leave it for the last. Do not bother about polishing the capsule if that's an issue. Put the lens in, it can be yagged later. So I think the points for the delegates, you all are super surgeons. For the delegates is, femto not needed in posterior polar cataracts. Use it if you just have to for entertainment. Mature cataract, yes, you need it for making it excellent. That's the point for the delegates.
I think some of us will not agree with that because there have been...
You just stay tuned.
Yeah.
You just stay tuned for my presentation, Arun, and you might change your mind.
Yeah, it does.
I think without any further delay, can we start now?
Going ahead with these precious pearls from the panelists, here we present Captain Viper, Dr. Abhay Vasavara. He's taking over posterior polar cataract.
I think I recognize the teaching of Dr. Daldis Singh from Amritsar, Dr. Bobby Osher, and many others who have taught us on this topic for many, many years. I prefer and recommend femto delineation because not only the Rexis control size, but also you can actually ascertain the integrity of the posterior capsule and produce the pattern and delineation of your choice. Having done that and having used the soft shell technique of dispersive and cohesive, slow motion technique with low bottle height and minimal to no energy dissipation, the central nucleus is removed. You can shell it out very easily and present it to the phaco tip. And then the next step would be to establish communication between the posterior compartment behind the cortex and the posterior capsule and in front in the anterior chamber. And that has been done by detaching the peripheral epinucleus in 4 to 5 clock hours. And having done that, then before we exit the phaco probe, injecting dispersive viscoelastic is something very useful to prevent the forward bulge. By manual approach of irrigation aspiration, maintains the contour, doesn't disturb the valvular function of the main incision, and you can remove, and we were expecting that clean capsule. But here is the catch. The surgeon is ambitious, he stretches his limits, and he does something which he should never do it. And that's his capsule cleaning, and he's trying to remove the print of that post-initiation ultimate PCR And the problem here is the two sharp pointed ends. So maintain the pressure by keeping the irrigation probe in the chamber and use the barrier effect of dispersive scholastic first on the tear to tamponade vitreous phase and then injecting cohesive scholastic there. And then next maneuver would be the objective is to round off that pointed tear so that it doesn't extend. And that's not that difficult with that balanced and well-controlled OVDs in the chamber with micro-incision forceps. And you can create a similar maneuver on the other end of the tear and then generate a strong margin and rounded end so that now you have a very stable platform for the IOL. And the IOL as a logo is multifocal toric combination. And therefore you need to have a very gradual, slow movements and take your time to align and rotate to the appropriate axis. And then you have OVD removal. You can use triamcinolone to identify vitreous if you are not sure, but appropriate parameters and you are through. Now, do not remove the irrigation probe. Notice the rounded rexus and a strong support and hydrate the incision before you remove the irrigation. And this is how it looked immediate post-op and down the line, 4 months, very stable, same toricity axis. But remember, posterior polar is not over until it is really over. And this case exemplifies, and Virgilio Centurion is the other guy who had a similar case reported many years ago. So be careful until the speculum is out, the game is not over. So I hope Arun and Karina, you will consider this approach now. Thank you so very much for your patient hearing.
That surely was a remarkable surgery by an extraordinary surgeon. Dr. Arun Gulani, I think, had a point to give. He was really
I do not. I think excellent surgery, but for the delegates, I would not let them go and play around with the posterior capsule in these cases. Doing a YAG is very easy. Posterior polar cataract takes 3.5 minutes. Visco dissection, very important. Excellent management because Abba is a phenomenal surgeon, but for delegates who are watching, posterior polar cataract, visco dissection, 4 minutes maximum time taken for the surgery. You should be done. Multifocal lenses, I do need to see vision at 6 months in these cases. Very, very easy to do a YAG, please. Again, this was a marvelous surgeon, but for delegates, posterior polar, stick to visco dissection. You'll be 100%. No need for vitrectomies.
I think I would, because we all are doing femtocataract in posterior polar, and for posterior polar, that is the only surgery that we do. I'm sure it's quite simple because you're offsetting away from the posterior capsule. You're not, near it when you're making your cylinders. And it's a layer-by-layer approach, which appears to be a lot more safer. And the best part is you can also see where your offset is and where your PC is. So it's quite predictable that way.
You can imagine I have and judges here.
I can't hear you. What is that?
I have bribed many panelists and judges here. Although I know Richard will never take that.
That's fine. My point again, I want to drive home is the fact that you can do it, Dr. Namrata, doesn't make it a necessity. It's an entertaining way to get there. It was a simple surgery. That's my point.
I think it's a scientific way of getting there. It's not an entertaining way. But yes, we are a fan of Dr. Vasavada, and I think Dr. Maipal will also agree with
me. Me too, absolutely. There's no doubt there. But the point is,
I'll just tell you that the specificity and the sensitivity of the OCT on the femto is so accurate that you can predict beforehand whether there is a pre-existing defect that is there or not. So this article has been published in the February issue by us in Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. Please go and read that. And there is 100% in all the cases we are able to predict, and I can tell my anesthetist whether to give a block or not, because where I'm anticipating a rent or not anticipating a rent. And as has been told by Dr. Gupta and by Dr. Vasavada, the pneumo dissection actually gives you, it's like what you are trying to say, a visco dissection or a delineation. It already does that. And you are able to take away almost all of the cortex, the only difference from what Gaurav said and what Abhay said, I 100% agree with that, that you go from the periphery and you get the rent at the extreme end. And we have never had a drop ever since we converted to femto laser on a posterior polar cataract. So it is not a fashion. It is not something to show to anybody. But I think if I have two or three indications where I will necessarily push the patient towards femto, one is intumescent cataract, phacomorphic, subluxated, and posterior polar. So that is a procedure of choice. And you can actually get very good results with that.
I think each of us has a publication from our group, from Dr. Vasavada's group, from Dr. Maipal's group. So you will not be able to convince us, Dr. Arun.
Yeah, but I think I agree with Arun. I think I must say that the intention is to be safe. And if you really adhere to the basics that you learned over the years, which you master, I think this is a fair and a very good suggestion. And so thank you, Arun. That's I think that's fair enough. So I think let's move on now, if that's okay with Tushya and Shruti, to our genius of our team, Dr. Roy Sethi.
I think Rohit needs to unmute himself.
I think we can't hear Rohit. Admin, can you please unmute Rohit?
Are we okay now?
Yeah.
Yes, perfect. Great.
Perfect. So thank you, sir. And thank you, Tushya and Shruti, for giving me this chance. My talk today is using a PTK. We call it as a scar track. You can see this is what we are using to treat a scar. The case today is a 25-year-old female referred for a post history of LASIK flap-related issue. And this is a vision. We can see that there's really a very low vision with the present situation. And this is a area of scar. I don't know whether it was a flap loss, a button loss. The surgery was not able to perform. This is bang on the center. And we tried contact lenses, but she was having difficulty because her T-butt was less. She was, and you can see from this, is she had close to 30% of meibomian gland dropout. So she was not very keen on this. And this is your OCT. You can see that this is the area of scar close to around 133 to 140 microns, bang in the center. And this was what was causing the problem. The vision quality was, you expect from what you see. And this is a topography, which you can see the small zone was proper, but the entire cornea is extremely irregular. There's a lot of epithelial remodeling out there. It was creating a vision like this. So what are the options now at this point of time? You can do a PTK, but the problem is even if you keep a small zone PTK, you will end up treating all this part along with this. So PTK is one of the options, but you'll have a collateral damage of treating a longer zone. You can do a FALC based on how deep the cornea is and the femtosecond enabled transplant. And the third option we understood was, I published this work where we do a very customized PTK of around 10 microns on the zone along with your epithelium, which is around 50 microns or whatever. And we have now the second paper also coming up. It's close to 3 years data on a customized, we call it as a TREC technique. So we thought whether we could apply this here, whether I could use, and at this point of time with no financial interest, this customization can happen only with Schwinn, especially the, because it uses the cyclotorsion and other things, which is from your Cirrus machine. And we, if you are able to only place this PTK on that zone, you can customize the PTK zone. And this is how we did, use the small zone. You can see that the PTK zone is extremely small. The long is 5 millimeter, the short is around 3.5 millimeters. And we use this, and you can see from here is This is exactly how it was. The PTK was planned. You can exactly zoom in to the zone, and the PTK was planned exactly on the area of the scar. And this was anyway captured to your, because it was through the cirrus, so we had captured the cyclotorsion also. And a small video of how the, you can see from this is the small zone, and you can see that it's exactly falling, the laser is falling exactly in that zone where we intend. The other part of the cornea is completely untouched. And you can see from this, this is the pre-op, this is the 1 month, and you hardly have any scar at this point of time. And this is back to uncorrected of 2030. And with a small refractive error, which is not really wanting, and it's completely normal. So what you see here is, this is the topography. You can see that this is a difference map out here. And this whole zone of topography has opened up. This was the scar which was causing. And you can see that there's a huge change in the pre and post operatively, change in your aberrations. And this is what we are looking at. This was the pre-op, and this is the post-op. And the same patient's post-op vision changing both from the, this is more or less from the corneal level. So this is the OCT now. You can imagine this was the area which was having the zone of scar. Now at the end of 6 months, that whole zone is completely, the scar is completely disappeared. You can compare it with this one here. The whole area was thick, and now it hardly feel that there was anything which was missing. The epithelium has also covered it pretty well. So that's one take-home point, is that you can customize your cornea using advanced lasers if you use your machines. There are future, we are working on future, you probably would not even need this. There are different ways of treating it with drops. This is something which we are very close to coming out as a commercial product. It can be used post-operatively also. It's an epigenetic modulator. It modulates the genetics of healing, basically. That's how it is called, the modulator, and this is the area which it works. There's a huge area of mesenchymal stem cell. Dr. Sayan Basu and his team are working on it. You can put the, you can use the mesenchymal stem cells on that zone, and this scar can actually remodulate itself. These are the two take-home points. One is surgical, one is what is going to come, and this is something which you'll be probably seeing, what I'm showing here as future, probably this year or the early next year. Thank you.
That was a thought-provoking poll for all of us, desiring refractive outcomes. Dr. Arun Vilani, what is your opinion regarding this?
First of all, Rohit, congratulations. I love the fact that for the last 3 decades, I've been pushing surgeons to understand scars as a refractive surgery. I love the fact of where you're headed. I also love the fact that you're heading into the future with drops, which is the absolute way in which remodulation will happen. So excellent. One point, positive criticism here. As you know me, I'm a very strong proponent for refractive-based surgery. You reach this point on topographic improvement as a welcome side effect. The refraction was right on a platter for you, a myopic ablation. As you know, that treats the scar beautifully. I've now done about 10,000 cases over 21 years. There are these scars which are refractory, which I've shown in my videos. And if you take them refraction road, it's amazing they land at 20/20. And in fact, I say this in a very blatant way. I don't care about the scar. You just make the shape, and you will see this in many, many patients. And that, in fact, is the reason why a scleral contact lens makes a patient see through a central scar with 20/30. So the same principle of corneoplastique, if you refract these patients, disregard the scar. Refract them, go straight refractive laser surgery. Your topography improving is a welcome side effect. You don't even look at that. The patients are blown away with their 20/20 minus vision. So I love what you've done. It's a great direction of the future. That's just my point of next level.
Arun, I saw your beautiful videos of the scars a few years ago. You very kindly showed us, and so mesmerizing. Wonderful, wonderful.
It was a pleasure coming there and speaking, Dr. Vasada, as usual. You're a maverick for all of us.
Thank you.
But I think the greatest thing here is the point of such phenomenal surgeons on this podium that we can maybe take it a little higher, push it a little more.
Is Professor Rasik Vajpayee there? Okay, so Dr. Namrata, what are your views regarding this?
I think it was a great case presentation, and Rohit covered both the surgical method of doing it and the medical method of doing it. And I'm sure the medical method is the one which is going to be the future. And I think I would agree with Dr. Arun that It was lucky to be bang on. But then the refractive part, Rohit, if it remains, maybe in some case, then how do you deal with it? Would you do a refractive laser after that?
In fact, for this patient, I had taken a consent form that this is the first step of procedure. And I expected this patient to end up with a hyperopic shift because I'm going to burn a lot of cornea there. But what happens is, luckily, I was lucky that she did not end up with it. But I was ready to wait for 3 months or 4 months, like Dr. Gulani said. I would have probably done a refractive treatment for this patient. In fact, I had asked her that I need to see her after 3 months. She does not stay in Bangalore. But she's perfectly happy now. But I'm sure this is one of this kind. But the second thing I would I'd like to say is, especially in young patients, when you treat the first time, even if you have a small cylinder or a coma or anything, the lens accommodates such beautifully that it kind of covers it up. But these patients have problem when you end up with 40, 45, when you have to give them a progressive glasses, they will not be able to tolerate. So the younger the age group, I think the lens is you're an angel out there.
One more thing, Rohit. Lens, very nicely, that's a nice clinical observation that I've seen over two decades. Most important factor that helped you here was her epithelium. In fact, I go so far, I provocatively tell refractive surgeons, don't look at the topography in this case. It's a clown suit. It looks bulky and 5 diopter astigmatism. It's nothing. If you even remove the epithelium, you'll see these scars actually lift off. That's the experience that I've seen. So removing the epithelium, I'll make this a point. Removing the epithelium tells me how good a corneal surgeon someone is when I see them doing that. The rest of the transplants are easy stuff. Epithelium is the thing that saved you here. Phenomenal job. Excellent.
And that's just to sum up on this, if I have just a few seconds, I've noticed that when the epithelium is removed during cross-linking by a very young first-time fellow or a postgraduate, these cross-linking patients end up with scarring invariably. The reason is they have no idea of how to remove it. But I have noticed this is a trend. That means even today, if I had to do a cross-linking, however busy I am, I do the epithelium. I can give my fellows to do a smile, but I will make my epithelium. I'll remove it because scarring is directly linked to how you remove it. Thank you, Dr. Arun, for bringing it up.
Thank you, Dr.
Rohit, I just have one yes, comment. You said that this is possible only with a shrink, but long back, I have done a few cases with the joystick PTK mode. So if you have a joystick PTK mode on your machine, I mean, even with the BNL or MEL 80, you have a joystick PTK mode where you can actually use the joystick PTK and then have a visual endpoint and you can just remove that scar area. So you don't need to have very sophisticated software to design this. So if you just have a joystick PTK mode, you can do it.
Yes, sir. What I was trying to say is, in fact, there's no software here. You just have to play around with the machine to design how much PTK you do. I agree with you. The second thing is, one big advantage of this was that it had a cyclotorsion compensation. Because it had taken the images from the sivus.
I think if it's just for scar removal, then you can do it with the joystick PTK also. 46.
That's a very great tip to deal with scar corneas. Next up is Dr. Ashwin Agarwal with his talk on extrusion cannula assisted levitation.
Well, Ash starts, I want to let everybody know he is our jewel. He's a very brilliant surgeon and a great educator. Ashwin, go ahead.
I hope everybody can hear me. I'm just going to share my screen and start off. I hope everybody can see the screen. So Dr. Basavda called me in the morning and he told me, buddy, we're going to have some stalwarts, but we need some smoking guns as well. This is Top Gun. We need to blow the Mavericks apart. So anyways, taking my discussion forward, no jokes apart, but all the speakers here have been exceptional. And I think going forward, all the international speakers, I'm just waiting and holding on for them as well. So welcome, everybody. My topic today is the extrusion cannula assisted levitation. I have no financial interest in this, But let me tell you, it started off with me having a lot of complications. I had a lot of drops. I have dropped all kinds of lenses, three-piece, double loop, single piece, you name it, I've dropped it, plate haptics, everything. Now, what's the problem if you drop lenses? The problem in dropping lenses and leaving them inside the eye is vitritis, fibrosis. I mean, we know all of this, cystoid macular edema, vitreous hemorrhage, retinal tears, detachment, epimacular membrane, and loss of vision acuity. We all know this. Some of the steps that have been followed up until now, and I think we'll just take you through some of the steps that people do usually before I came up with this novel technique, was they used to perform a core vitrectomy that was very, very required in these cases using an IOL lifting forceps. It could be any kind of lens, and you see the pinch over there to hold the haptic in, especially those double loop and the plate haptic lenses. Or they use a PFCL to actually lift that intraocular lens into mid-vitreous cavity and then lift it off with the forceps. And then place it in the sulcus is one option. Reposition into the sulcus is one option. Doing a glued with, if it is a three-piece lens or a intrascleral haptic, or fixing with the sutures is another option. The third option is to remove it and explant that lens if it's broken or it doesn't have any haptics, or the optic is broken or something like that. And the risks and complications involved with this is, first of all, that proximity to the retina of that forceps is a big risk, where it can cause edema. You can have a hole or a tear where, and believe me, we've all, at least the ones who've done this procedure, have had these complications. Look at this plate haptic lens, and this is probably the one which actually explained a lot and was the mother of invention for me, where I was struggling for 45 minutes in that case. And PFCL, if you leave PFCL inside the eye, also has its own complications. Then came along the extrusion cannula. So let me explain to you what the extrusion cannula does and what it basically is. It's basically a device that has a soft tip internal bore with a metal tip outside. And this basically, I'm removing that for doing this procedure, but it was used for retinal detachment to drain out subretinal fluid. What I've done is I've removed that extrusion cannula soft tip, and basically just adhering to the optic of that lens after doing a core vitrectomy, just like as you would see, press the pedal as you adhere to the optic, come up, and actually you can hold this with the forceps and externalize or reposition or glue or any of these methods. The basic steps involved are basically doing a vitrectomy, going adhering to the optic, and then pressing the foot pedal. Again, the position over here is very important. Do not hold it long in the long axis over there, because it can touch the iris and drop back down because it loses the vacuum. So hold the shorter axis. The closer you hold the haptic occlusion position, the faster and the easier you can supinate your hand. Just watch this. Hold it in one edge, supinate your hand so that it comes up. Now you can hold it and externalize or explant, or if it's a three-piece lens, that's the best case scenario if you do have those cases. And that's why in all complex situations, I always tend to do a three-piece lens. If it's a subluxated or a progressive condition or something of that sort, I always tend to do a three-piece lens so I don't have to explant at a date later on in case I have a drop or a loss of zonules or a zonulysis and where the IOL bag haptic falls down. And that's pretty much how I treat these conditions. Just this was, we published this in 2014, just a small mechanism. The IOL, the ECAL technique does not allow me to touch the retina at any point. And that's one of the big key factors of safety. As we were mentioning a lot of times, safety is number one for all of us at any point. The second thing is perpendicular. We are always perpendicular, and that perpendicular approach only is approachable much easier with an ECAL technique, where you're much more delicate towards the retina. And that's some of my pearls for using this technique. I'm not going to go talk more about this because I think this kind of explains a lot. And there are some more small tips that we can give and share for that. But that was my presentation, and I would love to hear a lot more from you guys as to from comments from the audience as well.
Excellent, Ashwin, for teaching this invaluable innovation. Very smart trick to avoid the complication. Well done. Excellent.
Do you have any other difficulties except The one that you showed where you had sucked into
so a couple of questions
based on the IOL.
Yeah. So a couple of questions. I think one is one tip which I can tell you is people ask me, what is the vacuum setting that you use for this? I mean, you can go up to 400, 600 also, absolutely no issues because you're completely away from the vitreous. The issue is you must do a core vitrectomy. That's number one. The second is make sure that you press the foot pedal only when you are adhering to the optic. Do not press the foot pedal all the way down. When you adhere to the optic, when you press the foot pedal, it's like a vacuum cleaner on a plate, and it just absorbs it, and you can just bring it all the way up. The third tip I can tell you is, as I told you, the distance from the occlusion to the haptic, because what happens is you need to supinate your hand to bring it and into the pupillary space so you can hold it out. If you are too far out, you'll be touching the iris on the other side, and that dislodges it because of the vacuum is lost. So these are small tips. The other thing which people have asked me before is, can you use this on a nuclear fragment? So what I've said is, I have tried it and I've also gotten away, but I would not do it again because it's not for a nuclear fragment, you need a active occlusion. You need an active occlusion, not a passive one. This is more of a passive one, and it can work very well with flat surfaces. So I would say that if you have a bag, it probably might work. But if you have just a nuclear fragment, it may not work because it has craters on it. And those craters don't allow a vacuum to be built up enough me to hold and push above the IOL.
And so it's good to practice outside the eye.
I'm sorry?
It's good to practice outside the eye.
Yes, it is. It is.
Two small comments.
Can I ask you?
I can have. One is a preoperative ultrasound is very important in these cases to understand whether there is a PVD already or not. If there's a PVD, then this technique is very easy. Otherwise, if a PVD needs to be induced, then first the induction of the PVD, and then, of course, yes, the technique that you have shown so well.
Yeah.
I think these two points, I just thought that would
bang
be...
Bang on track, sir. And all my cases, I always induce a PVD if it's not been induced already. All of them. I do it in all my cases, especially because in most of my cases, there'll already be an IOL with some cortical or some nuclear, I'm not going to take any chance. I'm just going to induce an PVD and go ahead with it. But yes, sir.
I saw that you were implanting a PMMA three-piece lens. Does this device work as well on PMMA as it does on soft materials?
It's a flat surface. It works on any flat surface. So optics of any flat surface, any IOL across the platform, it'll work on every single one of them. It's just a vacuum. The concept is of suction. It's just a suction device where I'm increasing my suction from 50 to 400. It doesn't matter. The minute I touch and adhere it, it just works. And I've done this from 2014 till now, 6 years. We've all moved over to this technique. Not a single forceps is used for any IOL lifting across the group.
Ashwin, I thought you said it was passive, but if you're saying 400, then that's active.
It is active. It is active,
isn't it?
It does not occlude inside a cataract, a nucleus piece. That's my statement. Unless you're able to occlude in through the nucleus piece, you can't push it above the iris. The issue will be pushing it above the iris. You'll be able to bring it up, and I've done it before. I've gone inside, held the nucleus piece, brought it up, but beyond the iris, it actually loses the plot. And that's why you lose occlusion.
Do you have chandelier illumination? Chained onto the second hand.
I don't use it anymore. But yes, it helps.
Because if your other hand, you had to hold the lens across before it falls off. Yeah.
No, once I'm in the anterior chamber, only then I remove my other hand. Okay. Only when I'm in the, when my haptic is inside the pupillary zone, is my suction is always on. So that's when I remove my second hand and I go through the limbal wound to actually hold that optic.
So as Partha is saying, you are saying difficult for an anterior segment surgeon to try it unless he's done quite a few vitrectomies.
No, this is not for anterior.
Yeah, exactly. So I understand. If you do vitrectomy, if you do retina, So if you do your retina well, you'll be able to get in quite easily, and the suction with the cannula that you have that makes a lot of sense, and it makes life very easy. Thanks, Ashwin.
I think that's a simple way to say how small things can make big difference. Geared up next, we have with us Dr. Sri Ganesh with his vacuum posterior capsular excess.
We have kept the best of best in the last, so you will see that very soon. Sri Ganesh, please go ahead.
Thank you, Abhay. Good evening, dear friends, and thank you, Dr. Tusha and Shruti, for inviting me. I'll be showing you something different. Now let me just get up my... So I'm going to show you a maverick move. So many of you all, while doing FACO, would have encountered this condition where during IA you have...
We can't see the video, Ganesh.
We can't see your screen.
We can't see this video on the screen.
You can't see the video?
No, you start again and we are not able to see that.
Share, you have to...
Can you see now?
No.
Well, you shared, but there's nothing there, Sri.
It's playing, but it's blank.
Dr. Srinivas, can you not maximize it? Do not maximize it, because the minute you maximize it, doesn't play.
No, it's, as soon as I click, it's coming on.
Jaswinder, can you help Srinivas, sir, please?
Srinivas, which player are you using?
Hello. It's from the iPad.
Kindly right-click and play it on some other player. So maybe VLC.
May I play it on VLC?
VLC would be better.
I don't have any other player because this is...
Srinivas, if you can save it to your photos, the video can be saved to photos. From there, it plays seamlessly. But I don't know if you can do it now. So just try it again and see if it plays.
If it is an iPad, just share your entire screen. It will come over there.
Ganesh has left.
No, he switched off his video.
Can you see now? Can you see? No.
No, your screen is not shared right now. Just share your full screen.
Share
and
your
the video
screen only, sir. Yes.
I think...
Okay, can you see the screen now?
No.
No.
Can you see it?
So your video is gone and there's no sharing of
screen. There is no screen sharing happening right now, Sri Ganesh. So you have to again share screen because it's gone off. I mean, you have to share the screen again from the bottom.
Oh, what we can do is...
Okay, now, can you see the screen?
Yeah.
No.
No, we can't.
No, we can't see your screen yet.
I think we can move on.
I think we can go ahead with the program and come back after one or two presentations for Sri Ganesh. Till then,
now,
you can save it to your photos. Okay, we got your screen. We got your screen, but your video is not there. So, Sri Ganesh, on the top left, where the maximize thing is, can you click on that small button in the top left corner?
No, there is no.
No,
the top left, as you take your cursor. If you take your cursor to the top left, you'll see something for maximize or minima or, you know, bringing it back to normal.
Green button.
On the iPad.
Just click on that maximize thing so that it doesn't stay on maximize.
What we can do is
I think I'll try putting it on to the laptop and
Save it to photos and then play it from there. It'll work. Okay, so we can come back to you later. Maybe I think we should go on.
Yeah.
You can stop sharing your screen. Thanks.
Yeah, so what we can do is we can move on to the next set of speakers in the team. So over to Dr. Shruti, if you can start with the team maverick.
So are we ready for the dogfight here? Because we have next up coming up Captain Maverick, aka Professor Maligwin, with his team. Over to Captain Maverick.
Thank you very much. I really enjoy being with you guys today. And I'm very much honored to be captain of such a great team, beautiful international experts, the best in the world. And I love the judges. John, it's interesting how you jump in and out of the cockpit of your plane while it is flying. So it's a dangerous job you do. And guys, it looks like we don't have any problems in India apart from posterior polar cataract. We still have a little bit of COVID around us, but we are happy to be with you today and to share with you a little bit of our experience. So I would like to show you my team, which is the great international team here. And this is the team members, Dr. Chi from Singapore, Dr. Baker from Canada, Dr. Chang from Hong Kong, Dr. Santiago from Brazil, and Dr. Ron Yeo from Singapore. And I'm very much proud to be a part of that team. So I'm happy to present, to give the first word to John Chang, who is with us today. Please, John, I will now stop sharing my slides. Okay, so please, we are looking forward for your talk. Please switch on the microphone. Switch on the microphone. It's on the left corner of your screen.
Unmute. Admin, can you unmute Dr. John, please?
Okay, bottom John, left corner, John.
Bottom left corner. You can see the sign of the microphone and you click
you
on it.
Hear me now? You then, hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. We hear you, John.
Okay. Here we go. All right. So those were wonderful and very great maneuvers. I'm just going to share with you two little tricks which you can take home tomorrow and start using tomorrow. Very simple little ideas and how to avoid PC tear during FACO. Okay, these are my financial disclosures.
John, have you paid royalties on this?
Sir, the audio is not there. You have to click share computer sound while sharing your screen.
John, we need the audio.
Can you hear? No?
No.
How do I turn on the audio?
In the beginning, it was coming, but now it's not.
Oh, no more audio.
No. Now we don't have audio from the video.
Okay.
Maybe
never
you
mind.
Can
He's
go
just...
back a little bit and start it again.
Okay.
And at the extreme right, if you can hit that speaker button and see if you can raise the audio. On the extreme right of the
oh, I see.
Of the bar, like of the queue bar. Yeah, just take it to the top. Yeah.
Here. Better?
No.
No, I think it didn't go to the top.
It didn't go to the top, yeah.
It didn't go to the top.
Let it go
yes.
to the right
Please
to the top.
Pull it,
yeah.
pull it.
Take it all the way to the top.
No, it didn't go to the top.
Drag it.
Drag it, yes. More, drag it more.
Further.
It's on the top.
No, it is not. It is midway.
He has to say it's computer midway. Sound. The computer sound is not set.
No, he has not set the computer sound. John, you will have to go right at the top where there is written stop share.
Oh, yeah. Got it.
You go to stop share. There will be three dots that will come. Press on that and then there will be a drop down. There you
no,
have
to... I got it to the top.
So also, Dr. Maipal is saying you go to the top of the screen and there will be an option there for switching the computer audio on.
Right
top of the
top
screen.
Of the screen where there is a red thing which shows stop share. Just next to that, if you go with your cursor, there will be three small dots that will come.
Oh, to the top of the screen, I don't have stop share.
There is the red stop share, but you just go up, there will be three dots.
So kindly share again. And while you share again, you will find an option at the bottom saying share computer sound. Click that.
Yes, I got it.
Yes, click that.
I clicked it.
Share again. Yes.
Okay. Share again. Let's try again.
Put the volume on high. Yeah.
Okay. It's it on maximum.
Yes.
Let's try it.
Working now.
Okay.
This time, let go your conscious self and act on instinct.
With the blast shield down, I can't even see. How am I supposed to fight?
Your eyes can deceive you. Don't trust them. Stretch out with your feelings. You see? You can do it.
Okay, I'm not going to ask you to do your FACO with your shield on and close your eyes, but I'm going to ask you something similar, okay? Now, the incidence of PC tear during cataract surgery is commonly reported to be about 0.3% to more than 3%. And for the best practice, is about 0.2 to 0.4%. And the study, actually this is from Dr. Chi, they looked at all the incidences during cataract surgery and found out that 60% of the PC tear occurred during phaco emulsification. Another study, 37%, but is also the most common. So you can see it's much higher than the other incidents. And I looked at my cases, and over 95% of all my PC tears occurred during the last two quadrants of my phaco. So what I do, I decided, can you see the video now?
Yes.
Okay, when I'm doing my phacoing, the first two pieces, I'm obviously watching the phaco, I'm watching my, looking, get a feel for the cortex or for the lens, rather for the nucleus, how well it's phacoing. My phaco piece is not my, and the nucleus is not hitting the endothelium. And when I get to this part, I'm actually focusing and centering on the posterior capsule. And I'm keeping my eye like a hawk on the posterior capsule. Okay, I keep, when I'm doing the fourth piece now, you can see I'm actually centering and focusing not on the nucleus, but on the posterior capsule. And you will see the cortex coming up and you see the posterior capsule coming up. Every time it comes up, I stop my phaco. So this way, another way also is I keep my phaco tip on the side and is less likely to cut the posterior capsule. And so, as I said, the commonest time when I actually break PC is during the third and the fourth quadrant. So move the fourth quadrant when I'm doing the third quadrant under the third quadrant while I'm phacoing the third quadrant that keeps the PC away from my phaco tip. And then I'm focusing on the posterior capsule, centering my view on that. And every time I see the cortex or the PC come up, I stop my phaco. If it's coming up too much, if it's fluctuated too much, another little trick that I do is I actually increase the irrigation factor. This is, if you have the Centurion, you can actually, there's a setting there, you increase the factor. What it does, it actually, much more sensitive. Every time the PC comes up, it actually refills. So every time the pressure drops, it will fill up much quicker. Okay, so rather than increasing the intraocular pressure, you're actually just increasing the gain. So it's much more sensitive to pressure changes. And that way, the PC won't come up so much. That's another little trick that I use to keep the PC away. So once I've finished with my third piece, as I said, I'm fixating on a PC on the posterior capsule, not the last piece I'm phacoing. I'm actually using my peripheral vision to phaco and make sure I stay away from the endothelium, okay? So it's just like also when you're riding a bicycle, when you first start writing, you're looking at the floor below you and you're looking at everything, you're learning that. So when you're early, when you're in your stage, when you're doing your FACO, you're looking at the piece, okay? But if you get more experienced, you actually get a feel for that. When you get to the third and the fourth piece, you can actually look at the PC. So when you're riding a bicycle, when you're good at it, you look into distance, trying to look for trouble. You know, the car's coming, or a football, the kid's running in front of you, a dog's in front of you. So use your peripheral vision to do the FACO and watch the PC. And as I said, the commonly reported incidence rate ranged from 0.3% to more than 3%. Best practice, 0.2% to 0.4%. And my present rate with a new technique is 0.15%.
May the force be intact.
May the force be intact. Thank you.
John, can I ask you, when you're removing the last bits of the nucleus, do you still have a second instrument in the eye?
No. No.
So it's surprising then that you get fluctuations like this, because fluctuations generally in this situation, particularly with the centurion, are due to excessive leakage.
Correct. And from the second piece, you're right.
Yeah. On the machine, as you say, you can up the irrigation factor. If you go into the settings further, you can actually factor in leakage as well. So you should be able to eliminate these sort of fluctuations entirely.
The leakage usually, as you said, is from the second instrument, from the side port. But if you don't have an instrument in there, there's no leakage. That's probably just from the wound being too tight. And then that's why you have to increase. So when you turn on the suction, it sucks a little too much and the fluid is not, there's not enough time for the fluid to go in. And then that will actually fluctuate your AC, your PC. But you're right, when you're doing there is an adjustment for the leakage factor. That's when you have a second instrument and it's leaking from the side. So John, there is a difference.
John?
Yes.
I don't know if I can chime in. A couple of things that I find in this setting that really, really helps. Obviously, the most common time for this problem is with the third or fourth quadrant. And what I like to do is, number one, I've seen it with all of these masterful surgeons. The phaco tip stays in the central safe zone with the bevel turned to the side.
Yes.
Now, that means the other issue is that on that last quadrant, your phaco angle is fairly flat, almost at Irish plane.
Yes.
And when you go to the last piece, you want to turn down vacuum. Vacuum is the key setting that involves post-occlusion surge. If we decrease vacuum, you decrease post-occlusion surge. So it's not really outflow around the incision as much as it is post-occlusion surge that gets PC ruptures on the final quadrant. So decrease your vacuum as much as possible and use chopping instead of higher vacuum settings, and you won't find that the capsule's coming up towards your tip. Keep the bevel to the side and in the central safe zone.
Yes.
I agree with what just being said. However, if we're talking about the mechanism of that issue, we published that on GCRS in January this year. There is a combination of weak zonules and anterior vitreous detachment. When the irrigation fluid goes around through the zonules and pushes the capsule up. So in that case, even if you increase irrigation, sometimes it may not help because the same amount of irrigation goes through the zonules and still lifting your capsule up. So you may need another strategy, such as using dispersive OVD when you do the last quadrant to have sandwich this last quadrant and separate it from the posterior capsule. I think that's sometimes quite useful in these cases.
Yeah, yes. I had a point.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, John, that is excellent, and all those points are what most surgeons would do. One item I would like to talk about here, I, in fact, keep my second instrument in the paracentesis for the last piece. In fact, that acts like a barrier. I put it all across the eye. So it's the barrier before the below the phaco. Now, I do not engage vacuum until I get the piece on the phaco tip. I think that's very important. I've seen people go with the vacuum around and try to pull the piece. You go engage either with the instrument or FACO, get that last piece, then just jump on the vacuum, everything's fine. Yeah, I, in fact, do use the second instrument.
Yeah, but that depends on whether you're using a peristaltic or a venturi pump.
Sure. I use a centurion.
A peristaltic pump, it's a different issue.
Exactly. But still, when you're controlling it with the second hand, the point I like to always teach is supremacy beyond technology. I use the Centurion with all the fluidics. It's automated. You're right about the paracentesis leak being accommodated. But any system, if you use your second hand as a protective mechanism, you can keep it.
Yeah. I actually, what I do is I have it on the side, and I have the nucleus on its edge, and I actually roll it in. So it's like a carouseling. This way, you actually avoid a surge because you're actually getting a hold on the nucleus, and they're just kind of rolling into the FACO tip. Perfect. Another thing in having the FACO on the side is it's going like this, is less likely to cut into the posterior capsule if you're going this way. When you're on the side, you're actually tapping. There's actually a study that did that, and they actually found out that if you have your FACO tip on the side, you're less likely to call PC tear than if you're going like this because you're cutting on the PC.
Yeah, but the other reason is because the irrigation is actually pushing the posterior capsule away because it's coming out of the side of the sleeve.
Yes, yes, that's right, that too.
John, well, John, on your last piece, just one small point. On your last piece, you really don't need to use FACO. You can just use aspiration and chopping. And if you do that, every time you chop, you break occlusion. And when you break occlusion, you don't get post-occlusion surge.
That's
so
right.
So you keep the FACO tip in the center, and you chop on the last piece under aspiration only. You don't need to worry about FACO.
That's right. Yeah, you can do that. For the softer cataracts, definitely.
I think this was a great tip, and it was a preemptive kind of trick where you prevent a PC tear, and Dr. Rohit Om Prakash has already, I think, described when you do have a PC tear, then you can use the fragment of the nucleus as a shield on that tear, and then FACO the rest of the fragments there on the top of the nuclear fragments. The ones which are remaining can be FACO'd there.
Wow. It's always said the wipers teach everybody.
Do we have Dr. Sri Ganesh so that we can have his presentation first? Yes, we do have him. Dr. Sri Ganesh, can we have your presentation?
I think you'll have to unmute.
Yes, he is.
He's gone.
Should we move on?
Yeah. Okay. Can you see it now? Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see it, Sri.
Okay. So, I'm sorry for that pitch. And, let's start off. Today I'm going to show you a maverick move. And can you see it clearly now?
Yeah.
Many of you all would have probably experienced this while doing FACO. Sometimes when you're doing IA, you can catch the capsule and you can get a PCR.
I'm surprised. Look at where you've got the
tip. This is a common situation. And if you see that the incidence of PCR is 0.26%, and most of them without vitreous loss. This is because there's a potential Burger space between the anterior hyoid and the crystalline lens, which prevents the vitreous from prolapsing. And the classical way of handling this PCR is to immediately put in visco to maintain the chamber. And once you fill the AC with visco, then you switch off the irrigation, remove your irrigation aspiration, and do a capsulorhexis with a Utratas forceps. But again, when you remove your FACO, when your IA probe, there is a chance that the visco can escape. There can be shallowing of the AC and then prolapse of the vitreous, which can enlarge the PCR and make it run off, and you can have vitreous in the AC. So the ideal way is not to remove your irrigation. And so we present vacuum rexis to the rescue. So this is a new technique of posterior capsular rexis. It reduces anterior chamber fluctuations, maintains the chamber, and increases the chance of in-the-bag explantation. It has some prerequisites. Size of the PCR should be less than 3 millimeters. PCR occurs during IA. There should be no vitreous loss. And the surgeon should be familiar with coaxial IA. So you can see here, we have had a PCR, and you can see that the flap is mobile. So then when you aspirate, you can also see that the bubbles are getting aspirated. So there is no vitreous in the AC. You'll have to step down your vacuum and flow rate to about 25, vacuum to 250. You can pre-program it on your foot pedal. And after that, you can gently turn your IA to the side, grasp the flap, and then hold it with vacuum and proceed to do a capsulorhexis in a very controlled manner. You can do a capsulorhexis. You can even release, that's the last part of the capsulorhexis. You can again grasp it with vacuum, continue, and you can get a complete nice capsulorhexis. You can see that the chamber is so stable. If you look at the air bubbles, it's much more stable than putting in viscoelastic. After you have completed it, then you put in viscoelastic into the anterior chamber. When you switch off your irrigation and pull out your IA probe, so then you can implant the lens into the capsular bag. So we had about 12 eyes with PCR in the past 3 years, and we saw that it's a feasible procedure. It is reproducible. And we did not have vitreous loss in any of these cases where we did the vacuum capsulorhexis, and there was no extension of tear, and we had 100% planned IUL placement in the bag. So go home and try this. It's not as difficult as it seems. The principle is to have a very stable chamber. There should not be any vitreous loss. And if you have a flap, you can see that the flap is mobile. You hold it and you can do a vacuum capsulorhexis.
That was a thrilling technique. Dr. Mahipal, are you there? I just wanted to ask you, what are your views on it?
Well, I think I've seen this, and that's an excellent technique that Shiri shows. The only thing is that it works very well in Shiri's hand, but there are very few people who can compare with his dexterity and expertise. So that's the only caveat that I don't know how an ordinary surgeon would be able to do that with so much of exquisite control and things like that. But Shiri is, I think, one of the best surgeons in India or in the world, and he can really do things, get off with almost anything. But it's an excellent technique, I would say, and a great idea. That's what I will say, that without causing any disturbance in the vitreous, you can actually... without going out and putting visco and trying to do a capsulorhexis. So it depends on an individual surgeon as to how often they get these kind of tears and how often they will be able to manage it. That's about it. But excellent, Shiri, I think.
Thank you.
Can I just make a point here, Shri? Yes. How many times do you think that particular IA probe had actually been used before?
We use the same IA probe. It's a reusable probe, and I understand.
Yeah, I know. Did you want to look at that video really, really closely? Because you can see the burrs on the edge of the aspiration port. That's why you broke the capsule in the first place, because you've got those little burrs on the edge of the aspiration port. You touch the capsule, and the capsule's gone.
Yeah, you can have burrs, especially in these reusable IA. You have the newer IA disposable handpieces made of plastic or silicone where it's safer. But I think there was a film also in the ASCRS showing this to have a very stable chamber. And if you can have that stable chamber, then you can get a nice posterior capsulorhexis. And it's not difficult. Some of my colleagues also have done it, and it works well. So if you try it, it works well.
Shri, you don't mind me chiming in. That's actually my work on silicone INA tips where the burrs were in the metal tubing underneath the silicone sleeve. It is metal burrs on any of these INA tips that lead to PCR with an INA tip. And if you can get away from metal and not have metal touch the posterior capsule, that's not going to happen. I'm a little bit more concerned about aspirating the flap in the setting of an open capsule. When we do a posterior capsulotomy, where we put a dispersive OVD through the hole, we're actually expanding burger space and pushing the hyaloid face back. But in this setting, you're not able to do that. And I would be very afraid that in average surgeon's hands, that they're going to be aspirating vitreous. You know, that would really create issues with our retina colleagues. They would be very happy, I guess, taking care of giant retinal tears, but our patients would not appreciate that.
The prerequisite is that you should not have any vitreous loss. How do you know that there is no vitreous loss? When you aspirate, you can actually see bubbles. The IA port is open and you see the flap, it is mobile. The flap is mobile. If there is vitreous, then the flap is not mobile. And your aspiration port will be blocked. So these are the two clues. When you look at the small air bubbles getting evacuated and the flap which is mobile, then you know that there is no vitreous and the burger space is there. The antrohyaloid is intact. When the antrohyaloid is intact, then you can do this. So this technique has some prerequisites. It's not that you can do it when there is vitreous loss, and you have to understand the principle behind it, and then it's quite easy to do.
I understand the principle. What I'm saying is I'm trying to improve your margin for error, okay? Because the margin of error, once we aspirate vitreous, we've lost our margin. We've actually already gone someplace where we shouldn't have gone. And not entirely necessary if we can quadrant off that area with a dispersive OVD before tearing it. Maybe tearing it with straight aspiration after you put dispersive OVD beneath through the hole. So you've separated Berger's space, you separated the anterior hyaloid from the posterior capsule. This is a critical issue because aspirating when we have an open capsule, that's how we drag vitreous into the anterior chamber. And that's what gets people from a small problem into a massive visual problem.
So that was a stupendous show put up by the Vipers team. Now, attention, attendees, now is the real show time. Let's begin the voting. Voting on, please, for the best for the Vipers team. The time starts now. Judges, can we please have your voting also in the chat box below? You can just text me privately in the chat box. So since we are running short of time, we can take only a few questions at the moment by the audience. The first question is by Dr. Matthew. His question is, are any of you using OCT to identify cases of pseudopolar with capsular defects?
So if I can answer that, we do have an intraop OCT microscope. So for all our posterior polar cataracts, we are using the intraoperative OCT microscope. And that really helps because it kind of just defines what is the status of the posterior capsule just before you do the surgery. And as you debulk the nucleus and as you go layer by layer, it also tells you what is the status of the PC. It makes it more clear. So it's really helpful. Some of the cases we even done femto and then shifted them to the intraop OCT microscope to see how it looks. So when you combine both the technologies together, it is extremely useful.
Okay, great.
We also have the OCT. We have the RTO 800 with the intraop OCT, integrated OCT. So we use it, and in fact, the resolution is better than the femto OCT, and you can clearly make out if there is a PC defect.
Great. So the results for the best teaching pearl for the judge's choice goes to Dr. Rohit Om Prakash. And the results for the best teaching pearl audience choice Mr. Jaswinder, if you can text me.
So it will take 3 more minutes.
Okay, not a problem. So we can go to, there's another question for Dr. Chang and Dr. Richard by Mr. Tanveer. He'd like to know if no second instrument is in the sideboard, then the patient could move eye under topical anesthesia.
Well, they've got an instrument in the eye. You've got a phaco probe in the eye. Yeah. So it's not as though there's no instrument. I mean, that's not really an issue, I don't think.
When you have two instruments in the eye, it fixates the globe better than only one because it can talk. But with two, usually it doesn't talk. If that what the person means, you know, they can move their eye. Topical doesn't stop them from moving. You need a retrobulbar to stop the eye moving. But two instruments should hold the eye pretty well, so it shouldn't move.
No, but he's saying that if we only use one, John, that if the patient moves, we can't control it.
Yes. Oh, no, we can't control it. But if the patient moves, he has to take the instrument out.
Yeah.
If the second instrument is there, that helps to stabilize the eye.
Correct.
Yeah, but you've also got a less stable chamber.
Hmm. Yeah, but then if you have a calibrated sideport incision.
Yeah, usually, I mean, it's a self-sealing wound, but, you know, you don't have time to keep the irrigation on when you pull the instrument out. I mean, if he's moving badly, you just have to withdraw. I mean, that's the only way you can do it. What I do also is I actually keep my my fingers on the forehead. So if he moves towards me, I kind of, a little bit of resistance at least stop him from moving towards me. You know, I try to do that kind of, but if he moves away, it's no big deal. So that's one thing I do is I try to keep my hand to prevent the patient from moving towards me because my instrument goes stop, digs through the posterior capsule. But if he moves away, it's no big deal because the instrument just comes out of the eye.
But John, I just take the head and then they can't move anyway.
Sure.
I mean, if you take the head, the eyes can move if you do take the
head. Yeah, the eyes can move, but they can't move that very far. And most of the time they don't move.
I think you need to kind of assess before you usually feel for that the patient how nervous they are, and if they do, we do under monitored anesthesia. So I think the surgeon should have enough experience to know that this patient is at risk of moving. So it happens rarely, fortunately.
Yeah, I was just going to say that the health of the two instruments is also such that you kind of learn to feel with the instruments whether the patient is getting nervous or getting starting to move his or her eyes before it happens. You kind of feel that now you have to do something else.
Yes.
But the most difficult ones are, you know, those who doze off to sleep, they suddenly start snoring.
Mm-hmm.
They wake up with a jerk. These are the biggest problems that we face overall.
That's why you don't want to give them any sedation.
Yeah, you know, without sedation, or they just knock off.
Mm-hmm. I wake them up.
Yeah, without any sedation. Yeah, you're right. Because
better to take the instrument before you wake them up, though, because they might suddenly.
and some of those heavy ones, when they're snoring, the whole body is moving.
No, I know.
I mean, I would still say the second instrument in the last phases is so important.
Absolutely not. I disagree with you completely. If you take the second instrument out, the chamber will deepen, which John and I know. The capsule moves away from you.
Got it. But the chamber is not an issue at this stage. Stability of the eyeball as you're getting out is very important. Majority complications that I see flown to me are at that last stage when everything is done well. Second instrument is an excellent way to control the eyeball. Keep the depth and maintain your toric lens in place. Always works.
And results for the best teaching pearl audience choice. That also goes to Dr. Roy Dom Prakash. A big round of applause. So now we are running short of time.
Usha, is this rigged?
Yeah.
I think so.
The judges have been rigged by me.
So now we go back to the other team. Opening up wings next on cross chopping is Dr. Ronald Yao.
Okay, let me see. Can you see my screen, guys?
Yeah, we're fine, Ron.
Yes.
Okay, let me just get myself organized. Well, good evening, everyone. Thanks for having me, Tushya, Shruti. Top Gun was conceptualized many years ago as a means for teachers to teach simple tips to surgeons or delegates that they could use really the next time they go to their OR. So today I'm just going to talk on a little known technique called the cross-chop technique, which was first really reported by Brian Kim in the JCRS about 10 years ago, in which basically it's a rotationless horizontal chop technique used especially when weak zonules are present, like PXF trauma and Marfan's. So he basically does a primary, like Nagahara-like chop, and then the second chop to change, to convert the heminucleus into quadrants is really the cross chop. So let's have a look. Here you can see this is, and I thank Brian for letting me have this. Here's his Nagahara chop, primary chop dividing the nucleus into two heminuclei, and here's the cross chop, reaching across, chopping against the stationary phaco tip. Now there's no energy, there's no vacuum, it's just pushing the chopper against the phaco tip that's sitting in the groove. Here, let's just look at it again. There it is. There's the horizontal chop. This is what I call the push, the pull chop. Okay. Now, are there other applications of the cross chop? Say when the zonules are intact. It was reported for zonular weakness, but what about when zonules are intact? And here I'm going to bring us back to the posterior polar cataract, which we've heard a lot about by the first team, but I'm going to help them really do the procedure even better. Now here, and this is where I acknowledge my Jisun Pei, who's speaking later, on how she actually used the cross-chop technique in the posterior polar cataract. Now this posterior polar, and we are also believers in using femtosecond laser, has had 8 segments done. Now after you've done the flex step, and you've done a bit of grooving, you can crack it into half. Getting the heminucleus, no problem, but it's cracking the heminucleus. This is cross-chop now. You can see that the chopper is going into the nucleus here, and that's pulling towards the phaco tip, and that's completed the heminucleus split. Now watch, the chopper is now here, and this is going to be the push type of cross chop. So you can actually do this also, whether you're doing pulling or pushing, and now your nucleus with the posterior polar cataract has been divided into really 4 quadrants using the cross chop technique very, very efficiently, and then you can actually see that the quadrants and the 8s are then very, very easily removed. So in the cross chop, you can do a pull cross, as you saw, and also the push cross chop, especially when you've done a femtosecond laser delineation. But are there yet other applications? And the answer is yes, cross chop can come to the rescue when you're in trouble. And here's one of my fellows doing an early case, doing a softish, what I call neither here nor there cataract, has grooved the nucleus adequately and is able to get the first crack in and really is able to complete the crack. So she's got 2 heminuclei. At this stage, of course, to do a stop and chop, you need to rotate the nucleus. But these soft nuclei don't rotate very easily. You can see she's trying to rotate it anti-clockwise and she thinks she's got it here. But when she relaxes the push pressure, the whole nucleus actually just pops back to the original position. One last try and it just doesn't want to go. So I thought that when this happened, maybe we could use the cross chop technique to come to her rescue. So I'm telling her, well, try the cross chop that we do for polar cataracts. And here you can see the chopper is positioned for the cross chop technique here. And she pulls it towards the phaco tip. And I would say she pulled her phaco tip back a little too soon, but fortunately she was still able to effect that cross chop over there. And because the primary groove had already been cracked, that quadrant up there is now a free quadrant. And you've converted a potentially tricky situation where you can't rotate the nucleus into one where you've now got one free quadrant. And once this quadrant has been safely emulsified, as you can see, you then have the space creation here. And space is so important in phaco. Once you've got that space, then it's very, very easy, you can see, to rotate the remaining heminucleus there, and you just proceed as you would for a normal phaco. So just to sum up, you know, if you can use this technique in patients with zonular weakness, but when you cannot rotate, as in a posterior polar cataract, or in that case I just showed you, I mean where it's a soft, or you mustn't rotate where you have a posterior polar cataract, then I think the cross chop can come to the rescue. Thank you so much, and I hope all of you can come to Singapore next year for our rescheduled APA-CRS. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ron. Folks here, because of the want of the time, we might have to reduce the time of discussion. So let's just keep it very crisp to just one question or a minute's discussion.
Ron, can I ask you the cross chop? Can you do this with a dense cataract?
Oh, you can as well, Richard. Obviously, it's a little bit, it'll take a little bit more force, but actually probably easier when you have something to push against. And the secret really is that if you have your phaco tip there and you just drag it across, I think Brian Kim in his original description described it up to 3-4+ is not a problem as well.
I think Dr.
Can I just say something?
Yeah.
I actually published the technique in 2007 when I described it for the use of removing a hard posterior polar cataract. It's in JCRS. I just looked it up. It's 2007. So it's before him, but I didn't use that terminology.
Right.
But I described it, and you can see it diagrammatically shown. So definitely, I used it for a hard posterior polar cataract, and you definitely can use it.
It's a nice supplement to the central step, isn't it?
Ron, just one quick point. The issue is that when we have a possible open posterior capsule and we're phacoing, say in a patient who's had intravitreal injections or prior retinal procedures, we don't want to rotate those lenses. And they may be hard, they may be soft. They're actually going to be a lot more common for us than posterior polar cataracts.
Absolutely.
And so don't rotate them. Use this beautiful cross-action chopping to remove the pieces without rotation. This is a brilliant maneuver. So thank you.
I think it has a wide application. That's really why I presented it.
Much, much wider than just posterior polar cataracts, for sure.
Or vitreoretinal procedures.
Absolutely.
John, thank you. Thank you so much. Dr. George, are you ready to soar now? Can we have his...
Yes, I am.
Perfect.
Okay. So, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to be part of this program. I'm learning quite a bit from my fellow surgeons and colleagues, and I'd like to share some tips for dealing with nanophthalmos. I have no relevant financial disclosures. Nanophthalmos is a small functional eye with relatively normal internal organization. It's characterized by high hyperopia and short axial length, and as well as smaller portions of the eye. So surgery is particularly difficult and fraught with complications in nanophthalmos, the most common being iris prolapse, iris damage, corneal endothelial damage, sudden decompression of the globe resulting in uveal effusion, retinal detachment, vitreous hemorrhage, malignant glaucoma, and ultimately, there's a high risk of loss of the affected eye. So what is the risk? In this study by Day and al., who looked at 103 eyes, the complications seem to be associated with the length of the eye. So the shorter the eye, the higher the complication rate. And this can be 20 times higher in the very short eyes. So this is the case that I'm going to be presenting. It's a 64-year-old male with high hyperopia. His axial length was 17.3, so his risk is certainly in the 20 times higher range. He's got a small cornea, shallow anterior chamber depth, normal being 2.5 to 3.5, and a disproportionate lens thickness. If we look at his ultrasound, you can see that he's got a thickened sclera, which is quite common in nanophthalmos. And if we do the calculations, we can see that there's a wide range of IOL power suggested. So what's my first pearl? The first thing is in planning the surgery and determining the IOL power. In addition to using all the resources that we have, don't forget that the companies that produce these lenses also have their own set of data. And in this case, I went to a Zeiss lens. So I contacted the company and their calculations were for a 42 diopter lens. The second pearl is shrink the vitreous body. You want to make sure that you have as low positive pressure as possible during the case. So giving 20% mannitol, 500 cc's over 1 hour, and you start 1.5 hours pre-op. third pearl, prepare for vitreous management. So have your caliper set at 3 to 3.5 millimeters. Remember that the pars plana is a little bit more anterior in these short eyes. Have a 27-gauge needle and a 1cc tuberculin syringe at the ready, and have the vitrectomy set at the ready as well. And the fourth pearl is using the Wong incision, which helps you to close the wound if something starts to happen. This is creating a pocket just anterior to the main incision. And when you hydrate this, this effectively closes the wound for you. So this is the case that we have, the fellow with the high hyperopia. We've set our calipers, we have our 27-gauge needle at the ready. We make an anterior limbal incision so that we can have the iris back and use your standard approach. You saw me palpate the cornea there and touch the eye to make sure that it was soft. I'm putting in high viscosity viscoelastic, and I'm starting the capsular rexus. This is my normal technique, and I certainly don't deviate from that in these cases. Complete the capsular rexus, and then I will do a gentle hydrodissection. To John's point, I don't rotate these nuclei. I just do the gentle hydrodissection. You saw me poke at the nucleus to determine the density, and I determined that it was too dense for me to use the Akahoshi pre-chopper, which is what I normally do. So I made a central groove, and then I use the Akahoshi pre-chopper to actually divide the nucleus into two pieces. If you look at my phaco tip, it's beveled down. I use beveled down in order to engage the pieces as well as to protect the cornea. Using a bevel on the side, our captain of the Viper team has shown that if you have the bevel pointing towards the side, you can actually cause damage to the angle and have a higher post-op IOP. So do the phaco in the bag, remove the pieces, then convert and add viscoelastic as you need to. So you may have to do that a few times. Do your IA and gently remove the pieces one at a time so that you don't have a lot of fluctuation in the and trampolining in the chamber. This is a 42 diopter lens, so you're going to have to increase the incision, which I've done. Place the lens in the bag and then fill the anterior chamber again prior to entering. Remember to remove the viscoelastic from behind the lens as well. Hydrate the wound, hydrate your pocket, and your case is done. So to prevent choroidal effusion, use the IV mannitol pre-op, maintain the anterior chamber, minimize trampolining, and be prepared for a vitreous trap or vitrectomy. To prevent iris prolapse, do an anterior corneal incision. Use the Wong pocket because that helps you to close the eye if you need to in a hurry. Keep the anterior chamber deep, but don't overinflate. And use small incision surgery, phaco in the bag, and replace the OVD as needed to prevent corneal endothelial trauma. Thank you and keep healthy.
Can I put a small comment, George?
Sure.
Yeah. Excellent pearls for these small eyes, and especially also for the eyes with small corneas. So one small thing that I do definitely in these smaller corneas, and if I'm doing a phaco, so use a rexus marker. So a rexus marker gives an assessment of the rexus that I need to do, and which is rather important in these eyes, because if it is a very small rexus, then the phaco emulsification and all the other steps get a little more difficult. So a rexus marker, which marks the cornea and actually carves out a rexus of about 5.5 millimeters, is what I use every time when I'm doing these smaller corneas.
I guess, I think you're right. I think you want to make sure that the rexus is the right size, because these eyes are prone to having a PC tear, and you have to have an escape. And the escape would be placing the three-piece IOL into the sulcus and doing an optic capture. So I think you're right in making sure that you have oval devices. And if you put that on the iris, it's very effective holding it back if you have access to that. But again,
the other thing you can do is to cut down a sheet's glide and slip that into the phaco. We're going to go over the top of the glide with your phaco probe or your other instruments, and that will usually keep it back as well.
So do you actually put that right into the anterior chamber, or do you let it stick out of the wound?
No, it sticks out of the wound. It's because normally a sheath glide is quite big. So if you just take a pair of scissors and cut it down to the size of your wound and then shorten it, it'll stay outside the eye, but also there'll be a little flap inside the eye which holds the iris back.
Good.
George?
The biggest problem, I think the George, biggest problem... Go ahead, John.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, when we're looking at these small eyes, hydrodissection is the point when, if it's uncontrolled and we don't control that fluid wave as it goes across the posterior part of the lens, that's when the iris comes out of the wound, especially if the iris is internal to the internal lip of your wound. So you want to do a very slow, controlled hydrodissection, and you won't have as much likelihood of getting iris prolapse. At the earliest sign that you have iris prolapse, you have to create negative pressure in the anterior chamber through sticking a cannula into the anterior chamber and aspirate, and the iris will fall back into the eye without touching it. That's an important point, because when we push the iris back with an instrument, we lose pigment, and that creates other problems, and the eye, you get a mydriasis, transillumination defects. So all of these points in the small eye, iris prolapse is probably one of the most problematic from the very start.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I agree, John, and that's why you do the, you know, sort of an anterior limbal approach to these. You make the tunnel a little bit longer if you can. And I agree with you. I mean, I thought I'd made that point when I was doing my hydrodissection, that it's a gentle hydrodissection, and you certainly don't overfill the eye and don't go in sort of three or four places, but make sure you have the nucleus cleaved and then go forward. So, yeah.
Smaller anterior chamber, smaller volume, worse problem. Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
Very difficult to do a rexus in these cases because you can't even maneuver your forceps very well. These are the cases where I would tell Arun that a femtosecond cataract would really work well because you got your rexus pretty well done. I had a dirty case with an albino patient, tremendous nystagmus, high hypermetro, 40 diopters, shallow AC, huge cataract. Now, this is everything going against you to make a rexus. And that's where a femto really helps us if your rexus is ready. And every which way, the fluidics have to be low because the iris is very fragile otherwise.
Great. Thank you, Dr. George. Flying next as the co-pilot, we have Professor Chi, the lady in olive green with the humble iris hook.
Hey, I hope you can see my screen now.
Yes.
Yep.
It's good? Okay. So first of all, I'd like to thank Rohit for inviting me together with the IRSI for organizing this. And I'm just going to share with you some pearls from the humble iris hook. I have no financial interest. So I find the iris hook really an indispensable device. They usually come in sets of four or five. And this is how we want to place them. It's very useful for expanding and maintaining pupil dilation. It can adjust the size. And when you place the incisions, it's very important they're snug and they point towards the edge of the pupil. You want to be very careful how deeply you push it in, because especially if you're doing it at a shallow AC, you don't want to hit the iris nor the capsule. And this is how you place it in a diamond so that you retract the iris away from the main incision. You can use it for LIDRS to prevent this when you lift the iris off the anterior capsule. And this is how you can prevent the iris prolapse we've been discussing. All right, if the iris prolapses, what you can do, especially during hydrodissection, is you gently pop it back and then place the incision a little more vertically and place that iris hook to keep it out of that incision. It's also useful if the area of iridodialysis there, it keeps it away. If you have large dialysis, you want to match it, you can use it to gently support the rim of the capsule rexus. If the zonal lysis is very mild, it also supports a capsule tension segment or a Sioni ring. And this way you widen the hook, you invert it, and then you hook it on, and that supports the equator, right? You can use it also to match the axis. You can see here it's matching the axis of a subluxated LL. And I'll show you the case now. This lens was floating in the vitreous, and you've got the marks there to match the iris the toric ring too. It also creates space for scleral sutured needle and also for the capsular tension segment to come through so you can place it safely. And you can see me placing the capsular tension segment with the hooks opening up the space because this is a contracted bag. And then you shift the hooks to retract the iris to create space for the needle to come through. Now I'm going to show you some Top Gun stunts. Right, so if you have a narrow palpable aperture, which often we do have, right, especially with these small eyes, you have these iris hooks that hit the upper lid. So to clear it and you, so that you don't accidentally hit it as you do the phaco, the eye moves, is you just bend the shaft, all right? So this allows you to clear the lids. Some people cut it, but then it doesn't allow you the maneuverability. This is a standard way of removing the hook using both hands. Let me show you this golden tip. It's a single hand hook remover, all right? So when do you need it? You say, well, I hardly even do this. Look at a case, for example, a case that's a subluxated lens. Once I've got a hold of this RL, I need my hand to release the hook so that the pupil can come down and I can then support the lens. This is another case. The lens is subluxated and I'm holding it onto it with some forceps, but I need another hand. Okay, I don't have another hand. So as I bring it up to the AC, it's a single piece PMMA, a single hand technique to remove that. And look now, I'm now using the hook to hook onto the haptic as that third hand. Okay, you don't have to rush there. You can take your time, support that. And then we have two more hooks. I'm going to bring this RL to be supported entirely after I remove the submarine ring. So I can use both hands because I've got the hook there. And now I've got the lens in the anterior chamber. And you can then remove these hooks so that the pupil, the iris comes down and it provides the support. So take home message, the iris hook provides exposure and support. And these are the new stunts. I showed you how to bend the hook. As you saw just now, the single-handed hook removal.
That was a great
show. Thank you very much. Thank you for watching.
Thank you, Dr. Chi. That was a great way to utilize the iris hooks. Dr. Partha Biswas, what is your take on it? Dr. Maripal, what do you have to say?
I think the iris hooks are great tools, and though we have a wonderful tool, which unfortunately, Professor Chi, you don't have in your country, and that's the Bhattacharjee B-Hex ring, which is a wonderful device. But yet, we do use the iris hooks quite often, and these small tricks that you have shown are really nice and very, very commendable. I usually snip off the extent of the hook if it is too large, but as you have very rightly said, that that reduces the maneuverability. Thank you.
So if you cut off the ends, when you want to remove it, you have to take it up from inside the eye. But as I showed you in cases of lens subluxation, when you need to do it yourself so that you can get the pupil down to support the RL as you bring it forwards, right, you don't really want the shaft to be cut short, because you want to be able to remove the hook so that the pupil can come down and you can place your RL on that surface so that you can glue it or you can do a Yamani. Yes.
Quite true.
So next up, fading into the sky with this technique is Dr. Marconi Santiago. Over to Dr. Marconi.
Hello, guys. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So first, I'd like to thank you very much for the invitation to be here today. I have lots of friends in India. I'd like to specifically thank the host, Dr. Tushya and Dr. Shruti. Did I say it correctly? I hope I did.
Thank you.
You guys are doing a great job putting together this fantastic meeting full of nice faculties and people from all over the world. I have, like I said, lots of friends in India, and to me it's always a great honor to participate, especially now that I don't need to be inside an airplane to participate on a meeting in India. You can invite me anytime. So I love to be there, but I don't like to be inside airplanes so long. So anyway, so let's go. I'll try to use my 4 minutes. Just I'll share this. Let me share this screen. Okay. Share. Okay. All right, can you guys see it? I hope you guys can see it properly there. So those are my financial disclosures, but none of them are relevant for the presentation today. So I'm going to try to keep the 4 minute thing format. And today I'm going to speak about what I call therapeutic refractive surgery and why we can and definitely we should do it now. So I will start showing this video when I'm removing. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. All right, so I'm going to start showing you guys this movie where I'm removing granular dystrophy and amputating a flap in a patient. This is a type of therapeutic surgery, a kind of therapeutic refractive surgery. But the reason why I'm showing you guys this movie is just to entertain you, because this has nothing to do with my presentation, but I know I had to show a movie, otherwise you guys would be really upset with me. The center of my presentation today is more about planning, but I decided to show that movie just so you guys have a movie inside my presentation. So the point is, I'm going to talk about topo guided treatment for irregular corneas, and the most important things here to one to get optimal diagnostic treatment. I mean, those that are very reliable, and also reliable custom ablation profiles. With a topo guided treatment, we can have it's a lot easier to obtain more reliable maps and highly aberrated eyes and compared to, for example, with wavefront sensors that sometimes are not reliable when we're talking about really highly aberrated corneas. When we need the most, they fail. And also because the topo-guided treatments are predictable, and also because the ablation pattern actually saves tissue, because instead of getting the steepest point and flatten it the most, it will actually make a kind of a treatment that is a combination of a hyperopic and myopic treatment and steeping and flattening part of the cornea to make it more regular. This makes it a possible situation for irregular astigmatism, for dysentrition in small optical zone, for corneal scarring and opacity, as Dr. Shetty showed, and also for corneal ectasia and post-penetrating keratopathy. The most important thing here, like I said, is to get reliable topographic maps. But who are we talking about here? We're talking about patients with decreased corrected visual acuity, any irregular corneas that do not tolerate contact lens. Those patients are very symptomatic, sometimes with visual disturbance, especially at night, double vision, ghosting, sometimes monocular double vision, ghosting. And they are some patients are complaining so much, they are miserable, they don't know what's going on. Some, most of the times they have been to many different physicians before they get to you. So it's very important to check when they are complaining like this, to check, especially if it's after any surgery they already had in their cornea. It's very important to check their cornea topography. So we start with a very reliable topographic maps, and then obviously you have to investigate potential vision with the cornea, with a more regular cornea testing with the rigid contact lenses. And then we have to also obtain reliable thickness maps. And if they have any opacity, it's very important to use OCT. It's mandatory. Then one of the most crucial steps here, which is understanding and looking at the topography guided ablation depth planning and how it would be, how deep this treatment would go, and try to maximize the benefits and balance the benefits and risks of the ablation depth and the safety. And here is one of the center of this presentation. If you have any information, any preoperative information before the original surgery that actually made that cornea irregular, you would need to add that information to the new information you're going to use to obtain your results. So all that together, in my opinion, should be less than 40%, especially in the center. If the original surgery was PRK, it's a little bit more difficult to reach that 40% limit in the center. So you can actually go deeper in the periphery. You can see sometimes the topo-guided treatment is very irregular. So this 40% is my concern in the center. If the patient has a thick flap, then you can use the flap thickness as the limit of the ablation. So sometimes you can just control the amount of tissue you can remove, just making sure you don't want to treat the refractive error. We're trying to make the cornea more regular, and depending on the platform you are using, I'm using the Alcon one, the Contura one, which is very reliable, don't have any interest, financial interest. It's very, it's a very reliable platform, but there are others that are very good too, the Shuin and some others. But the most important point is that here, I'm not trying to correct the refractive error. It's very difficult for any platform to, at the same time, make the cornea more regular and also correct the refractive error. So if I have to pick one to correct, is my chance to make that cornea more regular. So I have to see how deep I need to go to correct that. So I'm not worried about correcting refractive error here. Also, if the pre-op of data is not available, then I will use the residual stromal bed as my limit, and then I will use 300 microns. But again, this is not the most important thing. The most important thing is how much you change in the center. And this is just an example of the post-op of this trans-epithelium topoguided treatment. I heard earlier that the panelists were discussing the importance of how you remove the epithelium. And here, one of the benefits here is that the epithelium is removed with the laser. So to me, it also helps. So I brought here just three cases, just very illustrative cases, just to illustrate how we can use this approach, how we approach those corneas. The main purpose, like I said before, is to make the cornea more regular. So we can see here, those were very symptomatic patients. It's part of the paper that we're going to publish very soon. It's already accepted for publication. So we can see very irregular corneas, three different cases, and those patients were miserable. And then what we did here was to first, we planned to make the cornea more regular in two steps. Making that cornea more regular, what we did, we can see the post-op here in those three cases. Those patients are a lot better right away after the treatment, but we can have to tell them that they should wait at least between 3 to 6 months to make sure we're going to have the maximum results. This is the differential map. And also, sometimes I'm going to the second step, which is now correcting the refractive error. If they are still complaining, sometimes they are so happy that those symptoms are gone, and they don't even want any other surgery. They just say, you know what, I'm fine. I don't have symptoms anymore, and I don't even need any other surgery. But if they're still complaining about the refractive error, then go ahead and do it. Those are cases just to illustrate. And this is data from our study. Most the average best corrected visual acuity was 160, and now we have 2025, and they are very stable, have been stable for a year already. So this is an approach that is very reliable, and I'm sure the patients will benefit from it. So my purpose to finish here is the most important thing here is to focus on regularizing the cornea. And if you want, you can do it in two steps. First, making the cornea more regular, and the second step, focusing on refractive error. And the second point, the second purpose here is to respect safety limits. Like I said, trying to keep 40% in the center, we will avoid any further complication. Thank you very much, guys, for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Santiago. One quick comment, Dr. Arun, and then we can move ahead with the captain. Dr. Arun, if you can have one quick comment.
Surely. Again, doctor, I appreciate this attempt. It's a topic close to my heart. I've been talking about for 3 decades. Corneal scars are refractive surgery. My suggestion, as I said to the previous speaker, I love this concept, but I do not believe topography is the way to go. Topography, if you chase, it's like stitching a suit looking at the reflection in the mirror. You got to measure the guy in front of the mirror. The reason you've been successful most of these times to improve topography is that most of your refractions must have been myopic or central, which removes the scar and appreciates the topography. Topography doesn't correlate to vision. In fact, I've produced a whole talk for ASCAS where I'm showing the post-op topography has 8 diopters of astigmatism. I call it clown suit. And the patients are 20/20, and these are doctors and attorneys. So I love the direction, but my point stays. Refraction-based refractive surgery on the scar takes these patients to even 20/20 in most cases, and the scars are still visible. Not important because the shape is better. Taking these patients from PDK to PRK, I think, is a misdirection, but I love the fact that at least everybody's thinking about scars as refractive surgery and not as transplants. Wonderful job.
Yeah, I just want to, I agree. I partially agree with that. I just want to make sure I'm not talking specifically about scars in those cases. You know, those are really irregular corneas in most of those corneas, especially those that are shown here, are actually very completely clear corneas without any scars. You know, and Doctor, those patients are very symptomatic.
I have many such cases, so I want to clear this fact too. To me, there's no such thing as irregular cornea. It's just the lack of diagnosis to get there. You refract these patients with a streak retinoscope. Do not use topographies. I have 9 topographers. I do not look at them in an irregular cornea. I don't call them irregular. Refract these patients with a streak retinoscope. You'll be amazed. You'll be amazed. Their potential for vision is 20/40, 20/30, which to me in my flow chart is an indication to go with the laser. So that's what I'm trying to push here. There is no such thing as irregular cornea. There is no such thing as cannot be done until you fail in your refraction. If you do, then it's a two-stage technique where you first do laser, not PTK ever. PTK removes the scar, distorts the shape. Shape is equal to vision. That's what refractive surgery is based on for past 100 years. So that's the point I'm trying to get to. Irregular cornea or scarred cornea doesn't matter. It's the fact that it's an immeasurable cornea giving distorted vision of any kind. Chase it refractively. Try that and the results will blow you away.
Perfect. Thank you, Dr. Arun. We would love to have had a comment from Dr. Rohit Shetty as well, but I guess he's not there with us. So we'll quickly move on to the captain, Captain Maverick himself. Flying off next, Professor Boris Malik-Gwynn with his pearls on the weak zonules.
Thank you very much. Really appreciate your patience and staying until the very end of that session. So I will now show you my screen. And again, I thank you for invitation to be a part of that nice event and to be a part of that great team and to share with you some tips about pearl and pearls on weak zonule. So actually all these are great surgeons and even great surgeons sometimes have tough times. And as shown here with zonules, I really like to judge the tension on the zonules by scar fold. And sometimes there are surprises and CTRs are the way to go. They are quite helpful in restoring the zonular defects that are not exceeding 3 clock hours. And there are many ways to implant CTRs into the capsule bag. I like injector technique, which is obviously my favorite. You have to be cautious with implantation, and you have to use different other techniques for avoiding the extension of the radial tears as shown here. Even the suture-guided TTR is helpful. When TTR is in the capsular bag, it compresses the cortical material to the equator of the capsular bag, and sometimes it's quite challenging to remove it. When the zonules are ruptured on the area which is exceeding 3 clock hours, we need some special devices or modified capsular tension rings, as shown here, having special fixation elements that we can use to suture it to the sclera. There are some other clever devices, such as this one and that one, a capsular tension segment, that help us to deal with that. And this is the device I love very much because this is quite helpful. This is a capsular hook, and this is a case with a very, very weak zonules, and anterior capsular rectus was initiated, but we see that the length is very unstable. One of the tricks here is to use bimanual capsular rectus. I'm using the second instrument in my right hand to stabilize the lens and to avoid excessive movement of that lens. And at some point, capsular hooks can be introduced through the paracentesis and help me to stabilize the lens. And very good thing here is that the tip of that instrument is actually lying on the equator of the capsular bag and does not cause any stress on the anterior rectus edge. As shown here, I'm going with my capsular rectus forceps around the pupil in order to create very nice round capsulotomy and use the single hoop to stabilize the capsular bag and hold the lens in place while I'm doing my anterior erection. These are three hooks that are holding this capsular bag, and the two more were introduced later on. But in spite of the fact that you have three hooks, there is still a chance for the equator of the capsular bag to prolapse because there is an area in between the hooks that are not supported, and the equator of the bag is not supported here. So actually, you need anyway, you need to support the equator with the capsule attention ring, and which was introduced a little bit earlier, and this is the end of that case. So there are several tricks that I wanted to share with you, and pearls on weak zonules. And again, thank you very much for allowing me to be a part of that seminar. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Boris. That was a great way to deal with weak zonules. A quick, Dr. Vana, if you are there, can you enlighten us with your thoughts on this?
Oh, I think it was beautiful. Absolutely. I have nothing to add. Great work.
Thank you. Dr. Himanshu Mehta, what do you have to say about it?
How can you say anything besides what Boris says? You know, you can't add any single word after that. He has mentioned everything so beautifully. It's just that if we understand that the global concept of any iris repository, it's just a zonule. If you can think of that as a zonule and help you to pull your capsule, anterior capsule, and then attach it. That's what he showed so beautifully. Whichever support he showed, even on the model eye, was to show that how can you use that as a zonule and how can you make your eye comfortable with the iris. That's beautiful. Absolutely.
I think the discussion cannot be complete without asking Chi about her comments about these, because she's the one who has done real good work on it. Chi, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. I'd just like to make a comment about the bimanual capsule rexis.
Yes.
I used to use, like what I saw, something like a little hook there to provide the counterforce. You can use an iris hook there to provide the counterforce as you tear with, very few zonules there intact. To provide the counterforce, you have to use a second instrument. So rather than use a hook, I like to use two pairs of micro forceps. So I use two micro graspers from MST so that it's not a sharp edge, and then that provides the counterforce, and it gives you better control than just using a hook to provide the counterforce, I feel. Yeah, but it was very well done.
Great.
I have one quick question for Boris. I found that sometimes with my capsular hooks, I find that they tend to tilt. And is there any pearl that he wants to give us about making the paracentesis for the capsular hooks so that they don't tilt?
You know, as you mentioned, paracentesis is very critical. So, and it's critical to the design of the hook. So if the hook is straight like that one, so it depends how you want the hook to sit in the capsular bag. So in many cases, I tend to make the paracentesis a little bit more vertical rather than planar to the iris in order to have a good grip of the capsule. And I do think that may not very much prevent tilt, but that will help the capsular hook to grasp the edge of the capsule and it sits in the bag more firmly, more reliably. If I would like to think about tilt, the length of the paracentesis might play a good role in that. So if you wanna really want to make it longer, but with that longer paracentesis, you're actually lifting a little bit the tip of the hook. So that's why the grasp is a little bit less reliable, but the tilt is less and the rotation is less. So it's a balance
forwards and not provide that equatorial support that you're looking for. So sometimes I've even had to move it into the limbus, cutting through, you know, the area where is the gray line is. So I have sometimes to cut through conch, especially in a very deep anterior chamber, like a high mayo. You might have to move the hook back. So your paracentesis has to go further back in order to provide that traction.
But there are two.
It's always easier to support a rectus that is small than one that is on the large side.
Right. But the issue that we have to be careful about is the design of the retractors. So the MST capsule retractors have pre-made bends in them. And I think what Boris was talking about is very important when you're making your paracentesis, that it's much more vertical so that the tip that's supporting the fornix of the bag is up, as opposed to if it was in a more planar position, the paracentesis. So it has to be more vertical.
Yeah, I think Dr. Chi made very, very correct comments on the direction of the, you know, capsular hooks. I completely agree with them, and they really work well for me as well.
Thank you. I appreciate the inputs. That was a marvelous show put up by the two teams. We are certain that this was a thrilling ride. Over to Dr. Shruti for the votings.
Yeah, so we now go on to the most awaited time of the session. To make it quick, we will do two polls together. One would be for the best teaching pearl for the Mavericks team, and the second would be for the best team amongst the two teams, that is amongst Team Maverick versus amongst Team Viper. So we'll do two polls for the audience as well as for the judges. Judges, can we please have your voting in the chat box below? And meanwhile, when we are at this, and when we await the results, we can go on for a quick question from the audience. Dr. Bhushan, he has asked Dr. Ronald. Can we have Dr. Ron? Do we have? Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So the question is at, okay, so the first question is, which chopper do you use for cross chopping? Is there a specific chopper?
Well, I think any chopper could do, but you really want something a little bit longer because, and also it depends on the density of the nucleus. If it's not too dense, you can use a shorter one, but if it's anything 3+ or so, you want a longer one.
Perfect. The second question again to you is, at what depth do you embed your phaco probe with that cross, with the chopper?
Well, okay, I think for the cross chop, if you're doing it, if you've done a primary groove and cracked it into two hemi nuclei, you just put it as deep as you can, right? And in fact, even in the post-flex polar cataract case, you're still going to do one or two grooves to just crack it. Really, the secret is get your hemi nuclei cracked. And once you've done that, that's when you do the cross chop. And just put the phaco tip as deep as you can.
Perfect. Thank you, Dr. Ron.
Can I ask a quick question to Ron?
Sure, Papa.
Yeah. So, while you were doing the femto separation of the fragments, so what I did see is you went in and sculpted a little bit.
Yeah.
What I wanted to know is a cleavage is already there. So if you can just bury the tip and just separate out the cleavage, so wouldn't that work? Or is it a practice that you do for, you know, making one or two?
Yeah, absolutely, Pastor. That was actually my fellow doing it. So absolutely, yeah. I mean, you could just push it apart if you're skilled. But, you know, if you're just beginning, you probably just do two or three passes and crack it safely.
So right. I wanted to ask a question to Dr. Santiago. He's there, Marconi Santiago, or has he left? I think it was a great presentation that he did, the topo-guided correction of the irregular corneas. I think he's left, huh?
No, I'm here.
He's there. So I just wanted to ask you, you said for post-PK corneas, you did this procedure. So did you find any difference when you do it on post-PK corneas vis-a-vis corneas where surgeries have not taken place?
Yeah, that's a very good question. One of the things that I found related to post-PK corneas is that it took a little bit longer to be stable. So one of the very important things is to tell patients that they have to be patient after the excimer laser procedure. Sometimes those patients come to us and they are very already they're very you know unhappy with the results, and they are complaining. And I mean, when you offer them another procedure, another surgery, you have to start telling them, look, you have to be patient. Sometimes, you know, it takes a while to be really, really where we want to be. And especially those patients who had PK before this procedure, they normally take, in my experience, a little bit longer to stabilize. So yes, that's a very good question. And I mean, in my opinion, I respect everyone's opinion, but I mean, in my opinion, they're corner to topography, and I think people know how much we study and understand topography, and actually we are releasing an imaging book this year. It's going to be me, Dr. Random, and Dr. Dupes. And to me, and one of the explanations why this procedure works so well is when we see the differential map, you know, it's actually a proof that the topography has changed. So to me, it's a very useful tool for those patients that are very symptomatic, you know.
I think I would agree with you on that topography is a great tool, but of course epithelial mapping also, you know, plays a role as of now. This function is available with most of the machines now.
Yeah, sure. I mean, they work together. We have already also published that the topography is very important, but if you have the epithelial map available, not many people have, but if you have, they work together, definitely.
Where are the
Are the results out?
Yes, we have the results for the best teaching pearl by the judges, and that goes to Professor Chi Soon-Pek.
Thank you.
And for the best teaching pearl by the audience also is Dr. Professor Chi Soon-Pek.
Thank you.
So perfect. So the results for the
best team.
Okay, so the results for the best team, there was a tough fight, of course, but the best team by the judges' choice is Team Everett. And by the audience is Team Viper. Amazing. So it was a great show put up by everyone. We would like to thank everyone here, me and Dr. Tashay. We apologize for the glitches, but we would like to thank everyone for being with us, bearing us for so long time, and giving it a big show. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. For conducting such a great program. I think the youngsters have done everybody proud by doing such an amazing show.
Absolutely.
Well done.
And there were no glitches.
It was perfect. Very nice, very nice. Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks for the great show. I appreciate it from both of you. Thank you.
Good night.
Great meeting, everyone.
Good job, guys. Very well done. Care. Great job.
Thanks again.